All right, good morning once again. Thank you very much for staying with us. This is New Day on TV3, and we're just about going into the newspapers, which we already have in front of us. My guests are already seated. We are expecting one more, though, but let me introduce them, and then I'll let you know what the various front pages of the papers are saying. We have Theophilos Tetechai, member of Parliament for the Ablekuma Central Constituency, and a member also of the National Democratic Congress. And then on my immediate left, we have Kwame Jantua. He is a legal practitioner and also a member of the Convention People's Party. We are expecting one from the NPP, and when he does join us, we will be introducing him accordingly. But let us just go straight to the front pages of the newspapers, starting with the Daily Graphic. The Daily Graphic front page comes with a picture of the president, and the story there says, "We reject second most corrupt tag." We reject second most corrupt tag, says President Mahama. Also on the front page of the Daily Graphic, organized labor calls for suspension of tariffs. Organized labor calls for suspension of tariffs. Then NDC youth in Tamale Central on rampage. And then also we have a story that says Kolebu senior staff demand resignation of chief executive. Okay, so that's what the front page of the Daily Graphic is saying to its back page. And the story there says final year students of Sandema Senior High School sent home. We'll find out what the reasons are. And then All Nations University College student dies. The story is that we're told he fell from one of the floors and hit the ground. They found the body in the morning of yesterday, dead. Okay, we move to the Ghanaian Times now. Ghanaian Times front page also comes with the president saying the issue of the corruption index, and he says president contests corruption perception. They are wrong. That's what he's saying. On the right side, Palmer Buckle cautions pastors. And there is a story in the center line that says, another student falls from varsity block to death. But the banner headline for the Ghanaian Times newspaper is, suspend tariffs, organized labor tells PURC. Suspend tariffs, organized labor tells PURC. And the back page, 1,474 killed in road crashes since January. Just this year alone, which has not even ended, over 1,000 people have perished due to road accidents. Abolish NSS, YEA, Professor Frimpong Boateng, and then also women urged to lead fight against corruption. These are some interesting stories we'll be looking at this morning. The Daily Guide newspaper now. The Daily Guide says government cash for Mahama boys as president cries over corruption. Blows in parliament, and then also there's another story that says bankers lament low agric. Those are the stories that the Daily Guide has for us. And my last papers would be the Today newspaper. It says bossed workers to be sacked as redundancy exercise begins. And then also we have the GM fund net asset value hits over 5 million Ghana cedis. Stealing at Enum Rural Bank, 300,000 Ghana cedis missing. And Charles Mensah not chief of English among from. That's what the Today newspaper is saying. And then finally to the Business Finder. The Business Finder front page says businesses bare teeth at government over tariff hikes. Businesses bare teeth at government over tariff hikes. And then also banks profit dip by 48%. That's what the Business Finder newspaper is saying. Okay, so at least we've been able to give you an idea of what the various newspapers are saying, or the ones we have here in studio. We start with the Daily Graphic, which is our usual paper. But before I do that, though, let me introduce my third guest who has just joined us. We have William Ajapong Kwetu. William Ajapong Kwetu, he is Member of Parliament for Akim Odan and member of the New Patriotic Party as well. Good morning, sir. Thank you for joining us. All right, gentlemen, let's begin. We start with the story on page 3 of the Daily Graphic, which says, we reject second most corrupt tag, President Mahama says. President John Dramani Mahama has dismissed the interpretation put on the recent Transparency International report that Ghana is the second most corrupt country in Africa. Quote, "We reject it completely," he said at the opening of the second high-level conference on the National Anti-Corruption Action Plan in Accra yesterday. The president explained that there was no ranking in the Transparency International report. Let me start with you, Mr. Tetecha, Honorable Tetecha. You probably also heard about the ranking issue. Do you think that the entire nation got it wrong, as the president is alluding?
Thank you very much. Good morning to your cherished viewers. Yes, I think the president is not only speaking for himself. He is speaking for the people of this country, that is the Republic of Ghana. Ghana is one of the few countries in Africa that has really worked very hard to ensure that issues of corruption are brought to the fore. And various governments over the past years have instituted measures to ensure that corruption becomes a very difficult commodity to buy within the country. We may argue that there are still issues of corruption that normally comes up. Some are currently in our courts. Some also do normally come up in the newspapers. We also have institutions that have been mandated by law that also conduct their independent investigations to ensure that people who have been entrusted with the public purse manage it according to the rules and regulations. We also have the press that is also doing very, 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 very well, because the press is also mirroring exactly what happens within the country. So you realize that as a country, we have opened ourselves up and we are making corruption a very difficult commodity, because one, we have the Whistleblowers Act that has been passed by Parliament.
See, the concerns for many would be the fact that there really hasn't been the biting act of the whole system, where we have seen acts of exposure or light being shown on the acts of corruption. But really, after a while, the issue either is swept under the carpet or nothing is heard about it. And that is one concern that the local chapter of Transparency International, that's the Ghana Integrity Initiative, is saying that government has promised and I have ordered and I have directed, but then we hardly see any acts, people being sanctioned, people being jailed. The shaming aspect of the name and shame is not being executed effectively.
Well, I would not totally agree with you. Partially, yes, but totally no, in the sense that we are operating under the rule of law. And when you get a suspect, irrespective of the findings, you need to test the law. You need to subject the person to the law. And it is the law that will determine whether the suspect is a criminal or not a criminal. Okay? You know, we do a lot of public trials of cases. You take issues of, let's say, the recent court judges issues. As a public or as citizens of Ghana, we gave them a media trial, isn't it? But in law, that is not what we needed to do. So this will all fuel the perception amongst the citizenry that corruption is very high. But for me, what I'm interested in is the fact that we have mechanisms that is exposing corrupt practices. We have the press that is also very vibrant, who are ready to mirror any corrupt practices. We have government institutions which are also working very effectively and unearthing corrupt practices. And for me, once those things are being done, it tells you that the country is ready, or yes, the country is ready to ensure that at least corruption becomes a very difficult commodity. You have certain countries that do not even have the processes to even allow the exposure, okay?
So clearly we have the institutions in place to check the corruption.
Yeah.
Okay, you see, that question of whether they are, how effective they are working and what are the results we have gotten out of their, as a result of their working, is the concern that many
exactly.
have raised.
That one is debatable, yeah. I totally agree.
Let me bring in Mr. Jantua here. Do you think that we are winning the fight against corruption as a country?
Good morning to my fellow panelists. Good morning to our cherished Ghanaians. I understand the person's dilemma. But you see, the question of whether this country is corrupt or is the second most corrupt country in sub-Saharan Africa does not only reflect on the president, but also reflects on the people. And yes, the president would have to defend it because it's under his watch. What is the method in which this information is gathered? It's gathered from the people, isn't it? Transparency International goes into the general public and that information is gathered. And you see, perception is a very, very, very strong influence. You perceive somebody to be X or Y without actually going into detail to find out whether that is true. Now, what are the people using to measure the perception? Look at the number of corrupt cases that have come up under, and I won't only say John Mahama's watch, but under the NDC watch from President Mills to now, because they have ruled the country for how many years now?
Mm-hmm.
And the perception is that corruption is rife. Okay, the president yesterday indicated some of the moves that they had taken. But he indicated the same thing 2 years ago. And you see, it's based on the integrity, the transparency, and the accountability of what the president is saying. And for me, if that is the case, how do we show that these monies the president has said have been paid back? How do the people know, yes, it's been paid back? Because it's based on integrity, transparency, and accountability, there has to be an outward showing that it's happened. So I would suggest, and maybe some people might not agree with what I'm saying, but if all these people, for instance, Woyemi, has paid a certain amount of money, the check that he paid, we should display it in the newspapers to see that, yes, he has paid X check. This person has paid X check. List it in the newspaper. Let us see physically. Then people will say, yes,
the president, if you just indulge me to read a portion of what he said, he alluded to the fact that a number of the issues, some of the specific corruption cases, however, the government has dealt with, include the JIDA issue, where he says, for instance, 20.4 million cedis of loans illegally granted to service providers, including RLG, Craft Pro, and Azungtaba, had been recovered, adding that he had asked the Economic and Organized Crime Office, IOCO, and their collaborative organizers to recover the outstanding 40.5 million Ghana cedis. He went on to talk about the National Service Scheme scandal. And then a total of 18.5 million Ghana cedis has also been recovered, while 163 officers had been dismissed. He came to SADA and, listed a number of successes that the president thinks that we've chalked as a country in the fight against corruption.
And you think everybody would agree with him, or everybody would believe what he's saying?
So it's probably an assumption, you think? Is that what you're saying?
Opposition will say, where's the evidence?
Mm.
Show us the evidence that has been paid. And that is the point I'm making. If the evidence has been shown, graphically shown, that it has been paid, it would kind of drop that perception that what the president is saying is true or is not true.
Right.
Show it, evidence, because the corruption itself has brought a tag even on the presidency. So people are not sure as to what he's saying, whether it's true or it's not true. The other side of it is that we have politicized it.
corruption is not something that you politicize, because it affects everybody the same way Dumso affects everybody. The only difference is that Dumso is evidence. You see it. Corruption, do you see it? You don't see it. But we say it's happening. We say it's the bane of our society today. And so graphic evidence should be shown that those who have been seen to be corrupt are dealt with. Now, some of the cases have gone to court. And the most famous one is the Woyome case. What happened? What the processes that went through, what happened? Did we have the chance to interrogate the Attorney General then? Did we have the chance to interrogate those who were involved in the decision of paying that money to Woyeme? That wasn't there. Mm. So that perception is there, and that perception should be eroded, because it's not healthy. It's not only Ghana, it's the international community too. And so I believe that, yes, and I always say, once a president has been put in place, it means majority of the people of the country have voted that person in place. So that person is our president. Yeah. If you were to go abroad right now and they asked you, who is your president? You wouldn't say, oh, John Mahama, but he's not my president. He's our president. So anything that concerns Ghana, concerns the president, and concerns us too. And so we should be able to make sure that whatever the president's saying has the evidence to back it. He's listed this 2 years ago, the same procedure, the same process that he's talked about now, he talked about then. Where's the results of the first one he talked about? If he came back and he says, okay, this is the evidence, this is the amount of check that have been paid, this is where it's been paid, Ghanaians, go and verify. Mm. Then people will begin to believe what he's saying. Yes, what he's saying could be true, but there are most people who would not believe it because of the way we politicize things in this country.
Okay, Mr. Ejaponkwe, you think we are, due to some of these things the president has listed, we have, are winning the fight against corruption?
Not at all. Not at all. And let me say a very good morning to the viewers, and particularly those from Achimodan constituency. There's a saying in Akan that if your mom is dead and you say that she's alive, particularly a child, you go hungry. It's up to you. And so if some people somewhere doing their due diligence are saying that Ghana is the most is the second most corrupt country, I will not listen to it and do something about it, I will keep saying that it is not true. It's up to us. A lot have been said by my two colleagues, but you see, taking the Wormis case, for instance, that is the only perceived corrupt case that went to court, and we all, of course, followed it keenly, particularly coming from no other person than Martin Amidu, who is an insider, one of them. We have more or less gotten to know the end of that particular case and what he is supposed to pay.
Right.
He gives his own time to pay, and he's walking about freely, compared to someone who stole a good in the village and sent to the magistrate court. Would that person have that option of saying that, okay, I agree, I've been caught, and so give me the time to come and pay? So if Transparency International should go around talking to people, and the people of the country are telling them that Ghana is corrupt, and we're doing all those ranking, and you say that you reject it because it was not scientifically done.
Is it not that we have, like the president said, we have misinterpreted what Transparency International's report said? What the president is saying is that after the questions that the people were asked, the survey was that, what do you think of the fight against corruption in your country? Is it better? Is it how it is? Or it is worse, like as compared to previous years? So if they are saying that, and then according to the report, they are saying that we are not doing much to fight corruption, that does not mean that we are corrupt. That is another interpretation we are putting to the report. So if it is a perception, the perception is different from the reality.
Yes, corruption can only be perceived because, like you said, it's not seen.
It's doing it like doing so.
Yes, it's not seen. And so it can be perceived. Unless you get a core evidence, you will not see it. And so if, you see, they have collected data, analyzed it, and saying Ghana is second. So you cannot say that it's not scientific. It is scientific.
Social science is social science. Okay. It is not like going to do an experiment like in my field, chemistry, where you add this to this and see green and see this. No. This is social science.
But like Mr. Tetechai said, there are institutions that are supposed to, like Yoko, for instance, then we have the security forces, like the police, that keep an eye on these things that are supposed to be fighting. You think they are doing enough, at least?
You see, because it is not seen and it is perceived. People go there, and if they don't have the core evidence, they are set free. They are let go. In the case of Anas and these judges, he had the core evidence, and within, let me say, 3 months, is it after giving 3 months?
No.
Yes, the judgment has come out. All fired. And some even didn't go home with their booties. You understand? Mm. But in the case of other people, the big guys, the guys who were more or less set up by political bigwigs, Azun Taba, RLG, they're all the same. It's the same company. He alone has about six companies. And most of the corruption cases that we are talking about is centered around him. And then the Zoom lions and all that. They're all running around free. Why? Is it because they are big? Okay. We have gone to court and we have realized that, yes, they owe the country illegally. They were giving some loans. Who gave them the loans? Those people should be behind bars by now. Because it was illegal. Who are those? Have you found them? Have you heard anybody's name mentioned? Wami's case. Who else has been implicated apart from Wami? Who are those who gave the money to him? When the president then spoke that don't pay this money, and people overturned the president's statement and paid the money, what are they? So if you go around interview anybody in Ghana, of course now people will say corruption is on the high side. So that is what Transparency International has done. And they are saying that, looking at all the countries that they did this kind of interviews, Ghana ranks second. So if the president is saying that it is not true, it's up to all of us. We all go hungry if our mom is really not dead.
But the question for me is really, what has been the role, especially of the security agencies where Anas's case is concerned? If this were any other country, you would see the evidence of them taking charge. Yes, the president said some time ago they helped Anas with some of the cases that he's doing. Where was Yoko? Where were all the others? Even at this point in time, have we seen them being part and parcel of that investigation? Maybe they are, but do the people know? You see, we should always remember that Iyoko, all these other institutions, are responsible to the people of Ghana. And they need to know exactly what is going on, because at the end of the day, it's the people of Ghana who put the government in place. Right. So the majority of the government is the people. And if the people have been shadowed from what is going on, how do the people not perceive that what they're saying is right or wrong? Perception is 95% of what people think. And that is that perception should be lowered and can only be lowered by evidence.
I'm interested in what we as individuals can collectively do, you know, to reduce that perception, you know. But
Yoko, for instance, they've done a lot of investigations. But you know, our structures are such that when such institutions conduct their investigations, they send their reports to the agency department for them to take action. Let me give you a classical example. The DVLA issue. It is one of the classical examples of the work of Iyoko. The work they did behind the scenes to unearth that malpractice, okay? But these are things that will not be told to the public. But the institution is working. Let's look at the National Service issue.
But if the, like you're saying,
the case of the National Service,
the people
it was
who,
the same
who,
thing.
The questions would be asked the public. So if the public is unaware of like the some of the efforts that are being made, how then do you...
Yeah, it becomes very difficult.
How do you know?
That's the more reason why when these things come up, we need to make the public aware so that at least people will also get to know what government institutions that have been mandated to unearth corrupt practices come up with.
Let me give a typical example. Today in Ghana, when people are looking to air their views, where do they go?
Radio station.
Exactly.
The media.
They go to the media. If people knew that Iyoko were doing this type of work and Iyoko were effective, if people identified corruption in certain places, isn't it Iyoko they'll go to first? So it's important for people to know the responsibilities of Iyoko and what they do. So that is easier, as you say, collectively, for us to say, ah, Habi Jantua is involved in this thing. Please, investigate him. But if people have nowhere to go, and the perception is that Kwame Jantua is corrupt, how do you prove it? And for me, that is the key. We need the institutions to work. We need the institutions to be able to stand on their own, so that if we find evidence that the president is corrupt, the institutions can move in. Look, when you go to the developed countries we try to compare ourselves to, do you think if Cameron or Obama or any of these Western presidents was to do something wrong, they would not move in? They don't care whether you're prime minister or president. So far as the evidence is there that you've done it, they would go for you. Like, can we show how Iyoko can do that? Yes, FIFA. FIFA.
Yes.
And even Platini. Platini, we thought was, you know, wasn't part of it. He's been roped in. He's been suspended. And so it is important that any government that comes into power should make sure that the institutions work. Because that is what the people can depend on.
Right.
Yes.
Why should someone like a free and crab be sent to the presidency of all the hulabaloo that was running around? Let me go home.
The investigation should go to the letter. If he's free, he's left. If he's exonerated, he's left. If he's found guilty.
You shouldn't be to go and sit in there somewhere, transfer him from one place to another.
The thing we shouldn't do is that we should not use perception to judge people.
Exactly.
Yes.
We shouldn't use that to judge people. Things should work in the courts. But you see, the process of the courts also should be shortened. One thing I don't know why both this government and both this government haven't been able to do is to take away the justice bit from Attorney General. It should stand on its own. It should stand on its own so that they can go in immediately. You know, there is proof that somebody has been corrupt. I don't know why both governments haven't done. When the CPP comes into power, it is the first thing we are going to do.
We will separate
the
Attorney General
exactly from
PPP.
Yes. Well, I'm not PPP. I'm CPP. I'm Convention People's Party.
Yes.
I'm not PPP. Yes, we are not the same. Yes. We are different parties altogether.
Yes,
it is the first thing we would do, because that would now enhance the belief that when such things happen, we would get some results from it. Because at the present moment, we are not seeing it. And yes, it's a bad perception for the president's party. It's a bad perception for him himself. It's a bad perception for Ghana.
Right. Okay, so the country's image is at stake in that regard. And the president also questioned what he said was some critics or the opposition's excitement in making or giving the country that tag, that it is not an enviable tag. We shouldn't be happy about the fact that we are a corrupt nation. Okay, one other story we are looking at in the Daily Graphic has to do with organized labor's position on the recently announced utility tariffs, where we are told that there has been some marginal increase. Well, I'm not sure they are marginal, they are quite hefty, depending on where, how you look at it or where you stand.
Yeah.
But organized labor has asked the Public Utilities Regulatory Commission, that's the PURC, to suspend the implementation of any new tariff until there is some stability in the supply of power. It further asked the PURC to reduce the proposed increases in electricity and water. That was from a statement that they jointly signed and released yesterday. So we want to find out, first of all, if the PURC as an institution has not held on or suspended necessary increments for too long, and if they suspend this one too, wouldn't that be to the detriment of especially the utilities? I'll start with you, Mr. Jantua, on this one.
You know, where this situation is concerned, I find Ghana is between a rock and a hard place. It's a chicken and egg situation for us. We should suspend, but the costs are still mounting.
Mm.
How do we take care of that cost? We're still generating electricity. Cost is mounting there. How do we handle it? Now, PURC are saying that the increase is largely due
to a shift in power source since 2013, which was 58% hydro and 42% thermal in 2013, and is now 27% hydro and 73% thermal. What does that mean? We can't depend on hydro anymore. Mm-hmm. We've got to buy the fuel that will now help us generate electricity. Thermal. So, if we suspend it, how do we pay for that? And let me give you some statistics of VRA in terms of some of the cost they have incurred that has brought them to the point they are. Light crude oil, so far they have spent 647 million. Gas, they have spent, and this is dollars, 400.73 million. Short-term facilities, if they spend 38.55. Medium-term facilities, 160 million. Other trade liabilities, 64.7. Total of $1,311 million. That has now infiltrated their costing. So the first point of call for me is that it said that government owes ECG, doesn't it? $512 million. That should be paid. Secondly, the utility companies should tell us, with the previous increases, how they spent that money. I don't think Ghanaians are against paying for more, but they need to see that what they paid for initially has been utilized to the benefit of Ghanaians. At the present moment, we don't know. I think that we, although we tried to invest in the power sector, previous governments haven't invested enough. I'll take water, for instance. I was speaking to the chief executive of City FM, and he was telling me that in their office, they weren't getting water. And so they got the water company in to come and have a look at why they weren't getting water. The water company now dug where the pipe was and realized that the pipe that had been laid was laid in 1939. Everything was rusted. The water company now told them that if they wanted that pipe changed, they'd have to pay for it. They paid 13,000 Ghana cedis to get that pipe changed. Now, don't you think if we had routine maintenance in all these things, we won't be where we are today? That has been the bane. The fact that we don't have a maintenance culture with regards to our water and electricity has now bumped up the cost where we do not have the wherewithal to be able to take care of that. But then I come back to the oil industry in terms of how we spend the revenue. Yes, they said 70% of that revenue should go into the consolidated fund. But we know that the consolidated fund is leaking. And so wouldn't it have been a good way to probably reverse it and do it 30%? 40% put in a high interest account for such situations. So here we have an energy crisis today. We've put 40% in a high interest account. That money we take and we use to sort it out once and for all. And then the other areas where we get our traditional areas, where we get our revenue from, we tighten the loopholes and make sure that those loopholes are tight enough so that we are getting added revenue into the basket. Apart from that, the planning of adding value to some of our natural resources should be something we should look at seriously. So for instance, right now, we are mining oil, we are drilling oil. People would say that it is cheaper or we get benefit by exporting the oil. Yes, we get benefit. But don't you think if we added value to a certain portion, whereby we get Tor to expand better, so that we can refine some of our own crude, and even export to Mali and surrounding areas. Will we not get more money for that? Would we not do that?
So an issue of priority is also in here.
An issue of priority, an issue of planning, and an issue of social consensus within the political parties in this country, where there are certain situations that are inimical to the ordinary man, that the ordinary man has to benefit from. We have to be able to sit around the table as a political parties, the way Canada did. Canada was in a similar situation in the 90s, where their GDP and their debt was so high The government then said that, yes, we are the government, but we have to call all political parties. Let's sit down and see how we can solve this problem so that we don't get in there into this position again. And they were able to do it. They put the right regulations in place. They put the right laws in place. So when, just recently, we had financial problems in the West, did you hear Canada being part of it? No. So it is high time that there are certain things we shouldn't politicize too much, especially when it concerns the people. And for me, energy, education, health, and housing, and agriculture are key areas that we cannot afford to play politics with.
Okay. Right. Yes, the issue of whether we should pay or not, I mean, that's what the pay we will pay. But organized labor is saying that it should be suspended. Is that a call you would agree with?
No, I wouldn't. Just like you said, the chicken and egg situation, we don't know which one to start with first. But the thing is, we need a power now. And the general consensus is that we're having generation problems. Now the power budgets are in. They need to be fueled. It comes with cost. And they are saying that this is the cost of fueling the budget for us to have the power. So let's all have the benefit of the doubt and do the payment on condition. Maybe say for 3 months, 5 months, 6 months. And see that whether really we'll have the power or not. Because if we don't fuel it, we're not going to get the power anyway. Mm-hmm. And the government itself, just like we are told, owes the power organizations so much that the government is not finding money to go and pay. Okay? And so I think that we should go ahead and pay. And then ensure that, of course, once we have paid, we'll get the power. But coming to the generation ratio, hydro and then thermal, I'm wondering why we have sat down until now for the ratio to turn in favor of, thermal. Mm. I mean, when you used to have about 70% hydro, 30% thermal, it came to about 42, 58, and now it's almost hydro is about what? Is it 27%? 27. It's dangerous.
And 73 thermal.
It's dangerous. But well, the rivers are there. I mean, the water sources are there. But
we can't depend on hydro anymore. Clearly, the water bodies are there. They are running our galamsey activities and all of that. Is so affecting
that is
it.
That is what I'm coming to.
Is affecting
it's,
it.
You see, it's laws and regulations.
It's your side.
Yes. Laws and regulations. No human being can live in any other place if regulations and laws are not working. So every political party that comes into power, like you said, Canada, consciously, they said we're going to do this. Consciously. Ghanaians, we should all sit there and say, this is what we want to do. We know what to do to get out of all this mess. We know it. It all boils down to, you're talking about, much of the thing that you're talking about was revenue generation. That we should tighten the loopholes. Mm. It goes back to our first topic, corruption. We have the means to make the money.
And then also,
now why is the money
and
not
then
coming?
Also the issue of political will and over politicization of a number of these things, because I mean, you are of the NPP, and the day the announcement of the new tariff were made, the NPP also released a statement describing it as evil, as an evil gift the government is giving to Ghanaians. So maybe these are your personal views that Ghanaians should go ahead and pay.
I can't hear, but
your party is in.
But I don't speak the mind of the NPP, but where there is a need for us, of course, to talk about the bad side of any government that will, if the government does anything good, I will.
Right.
Of course, but in this situation, it is too difficult for Ghanaians to pay. But I think that, like in my video, say, if you have a saw, and you don't want to, if you don't treat it very well, of course, you are going to let the saw keep going on. And so we need to take that bitter pill before it will be resolved. And let's hope that as we pay this bill, the power situation will be restored. Because you see, it is always power and water, because without power, you can't power the water. And the last 3 days, I had the opportunity of listening to Stanley something of
Stanley
Ghana Water.
Mate
of Ghana Water Company, just here in your radio studios. And I was amazed as I listened to him. I was surprised. I was shocked. Like he's saying, at the entire area, they are now saying water is flowing, blah, blah, blah. But in some areas, going to Asalbutri, it doesn't flow. Why? Because all the pipes there are not good. And they are asking us